Faith Church.
Good morning.
For those of you who don't know me, I'm Larry Leland. I'm blessed to be one of the pastors here, and we are so grateful that you've chosen to spend a part of your weekend connecting with God and connecting with the people of God here at Faith. It is a big Sunday, a lot going on. It is Scout Sunday. The first Sunday in February is traditionally Scout Sunday, and we are blessed here at Faith Church to have a decades-long relationship with Scout, Troop, and Pack. And some of those guys and their leaders are helping us out this morning, greeters, reading, serving in a variety of ways. And so we're grateful for their presence with us and for your encouragement of them. Immediately following the service, we encourage you to go out and to talk to some of our scouts. But especially if you're interested, they have a couple of events coming up. One is a pancake breakfast and one is a spaghetti supper. You can buy your tickets at those blue tables following worship this morning. If you're worshiping with us online, we want to say welcome to you, and a reminder that everything that you need for the service will be on the screens in front of you. But if you did want a copy of the bulletin, you can click on one of those blue buttons on our Facebook page or on our website. Same thing about the Connect card. You can fill one of those out electronically, and we encourage you to do that. If you are worshiping with us here in the FCC or in the Faith Cafe, we invite you to take that bulletin out. And at the back of the bulletin, there is a Connect card. We invite you to fill that Connect card out, tear it out of your bulletin, and a little bit later, as we receive our offering, we invite you to give that as a part of your giving back to God. The Connect card we ask you to fill out, whether it's your first time worshiping with us or if you're here every weekend. It's one of the ways that we follow up with our guests. It's one of the primary ways that we receive prayer requests, and it's also one of the ways that we encourage folks to take next steps in their faith. So welcome again, Jessica Nyman, who is our Director of Children's Ministry here at Faith Church, has some important announcements that she wanted to share with us this morning.
Good morning, Faith Church. I'm bringing New Year announcements this morning. Lent is almost upon us, and Lent is a season of 40 days, not counting Sundays, which begins on Ash Wednesday and ends on Holy Saturday. You are invited to come and experience a time of intimate worship, prayer, and confession as we spend some time returning and remembering what God has done for us. A service for all ages will be held on Wednesday, February 14th at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary. There are two retreats coming up this spring. The first one is a ladies' retreat. Mark your calendars, March 22nd and 23rd for women of all ages. If you are interested in more information, there will be a meeting held after the first service in Faith Cafe on February 11th and after the second service in room 21. Hope to see you there. Also, our teens are having their spring retreat at Wesley Forest, March 15th and 17th. Check it out in your bulletin. There's a QR code that will give you all the details. And finally, we are invited to participate in our Appalachia Service Project. If you're interested, mark your calendars now. Summer is just around the corner, July 7th through the 13th, and we'll be blessing our neighbors in West Virginia by providing critical repairs to their homes, keeping them safer, drier, warmer. If you're interested in this, you can talk to Mason Nyman, and there will be a meeting about this service project and all the details on February 18th after worship. This is a wonderful opportunity for us to bless our neighbors and enjoy fellowship with one another as we travel. Okay, Faith Church, that's all of your announcements. Have a great Sunday.
Thank you, Jessica. Isn't she great? She is. I'm a little partial that she's my wife, so. Good morning, Faith Church. It is so good to see your beautiful faces fashioned in the image of God. I invite you to stand if you're able. If you're worshiping with us online, you are invited to take a posture of worship, and I'm going to fight my stand. There we go. We are wrapping up our Peace of Mind series, and today is about how we have full God who walks with us. And so in Hebrews, it says that Jesus is not ashamed to call us his brothers and sisters, his family. I don't know how many of you maybe don't feel like you'd be in that category. And even in the book of John, he goes so far as to call us his friends, to walk with us through the goodness and the badness and goodness. So this morning, we're going to start off singing, What a Friend. And this isn't a light thing that the God of the universe has called us friend and invited us into his life and to walk with him. So let's join together and sing.
Everybody has trials and temptation. Everybody knows heartbreak, isolation. Are gone. I see grace on every horizon, and forever and ever his heart is my home. Everybody has fears, everybody got worry. Everybody knows sorrow, devastation. Ooh, 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 ooh. We can lay our burdens down. Lay our burdens down. What a friend we have in Jesus. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon. and forever and ever His heart is my home. No more betrayal, for He is faithful. He fills me up when my cup runneth over. No more betrayal, for He is faithful. How He has proven it over and over. No more betrayal, for He is faithful. He fills me up when my cup runneth over. No more betrayal, for He is faithful. He has proven it over and over, over and over. The friend we have in Jesus, East to West, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon, and forever and ever His heart is my home. What a friend we have in Jesus, East to West, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon, and forever and ever His heart is my home. Forever and ever His heart is my home.
Amen. He is so good, y'all. He is so good. He also says in the book of John, in the book of Matthew, He says, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest for your soul. So if you're coming this morning, you are weary and heavy burdened, you're coming to a good God who calls you brother or sister and friend. You can lay your burden down.
You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies. You've been trying to fill the same old holes inside. There's a better life. There's a better life. God paints. He's a pain taker. You feel lost. He's a way maker. You need freedom, a saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, He's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. It's a better life. There's a better life. You've got pain. He's a pain taker. You feel lost. He's a way maker. You need freedom, saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, He's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. Believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. You got pain, He's a pain taker. Feel lost, He's a way maker. You need freedom, saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, He's a chain breaker. If you need freedom, saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, He's a chain breaker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Will you pray with me? Good and loving God, for these moments that we come to you in worship and in praise, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to gather with sisters and brothers, regardless of what's going on in our personal lives, and come bringing all of that with us and simply being together with you and with one another. And we pray, oh God, that as we gather for worship this morning, that your presence would be made real in each and every one of our lives. For some of us, that's going to be in a song lyric that we sing. For others, it's going to be as we share around the communion table and we receive the gifts of your body and your blood again. And for still others, it's going to be in a word that is spoken or in the silence of our hearts. And however you meet us in these moments, we will thank you and we will praise you. And we open ourselves to the work that you want to do in us and through us as your people today and in the days and weeks and months to come. And so we thank you for the gift of worship, for the gift of song and silence, for the gift of prayer, for the gift of hearing your word, for the gift of one another. And we pray, thanking you for all of it in Jesus' name and by the Spirit that raised him from the dead. And together all God's people said, amen. Friends, now we invite you to, before you have a seat, just take a couple of moments and say hello to one another.
Our scripture for us.
Today's scripture comes from Sadducees chapter 4, verses 9 through 12. Two are better than one because they have good return for their labor. If either one of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. Also, two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three stands is not quickly broken.
All right, thank you. So friends, if you've been with us the last couple of weeks, like Mason said, we are wrapping up this series of messages that is focusing on the intersection between our Christian faith, our walk with Jesus, and the realities of mental and emotional health struggles that many of us wrestle with. Over the last several weeks, we have sought to speak the truth that God cares about our emotional and our mental health just as surely as he cares about all facets of our lives. God's desire for us is wholeness in every nook and cranny of who we are. And we have been honest about the fact that Christians struggle with mental and emotional health struggles just as surely as we struggle with other physical challenges in our lives. While we walk with Jesus, we know that life is still hard, and part of living in a broken world is dealing with brokenness in our minds as well as in our bodies. In this world, Jesus said to his disciples, "You will have trouble." But here's the promise. And it's the promise that we proclaim and claim as our own, even in the midst of those struggles. The promise is this: I have overcome the world, Jesus says. So throughout the conversations over the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about anxiety, we've been talking about depression, we've been talking about experiencing or seeking healing from trauma. We wanted to do a few things in all of it. First, we wanted to remove the stigma around seeking help for emotional and mental health struggles for us as Christians, because we believe that as followers of Jesus, we should avail ourselves of all of the resources that God has provided us for walking toward wholeness. Things like counseling and medication, nutrition, exercise, spiritual practices, community, just to name a few. And second, we want to increase a well of compassion in each of us so that when those we care about experience struggles with mental illness or any form of mental suffering, that we can respond with grace and with love. And finally, we want to give us all some practical tips founded in the scriptures for how to walk alongside others who may be struggling. And throughout this series, we have said the same thing again and again. We have said, we love you, God loves you, and we will walk through this together. And today we're going to talk about more about how we walk through these challenges together. So I'm going to invite you to pray with me. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for your word contained in the stories and pages of scripture, like that passage read for us from Ecclesiastes. And we thank you for your word made flesh in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And we pray that that word would come alive for us as we gather today, as we will often ask, teach us and touch us, challenge us and change us from the inside out. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning we are blessed to have with us a guest, and I'm going to invite Allison to come forward and join me here on the stage. And as she does, will you offer Allison your best Faith Church welcome? So Allison Kepler is a licensed professional counselor who has been walking with folks in a variety of ways since 2010. Allison is a graduate of St. David's University near Philadelphia for both her undergraduate and her graduate work, and she currently works at Cornerstone Health in Williamsport. Allison is also a follower of Jesus who has been a part of Stephen's ministry, which is a kind of one-on-one intensive caregiving ministry as a part of her home church. And so, Allison, first of all, thank you for being here. Thank you for sharing your wisdom and your experiences with us. We are incredibly grateful that you've been willing to do this over the course of this series. And if you haven't been able to be with us, we invite you to go back to our YouTube channel or our website and see some of those other opportunities where we've heard from others in our community who've shared their experiences in what I believe are pretty powerful and healing ways. But Allison, when we talked a few weeks ago, we talked about what we wanted to share as far as tips for how to walk alongside folks who are dealing with mental and emotional health struggles. And before we go any further, just a reminder that today we're talking about specifically walking alongside someone who's dealing with some mental suffering or some mental illness. But what we're talking about this whole series and specifically today, it is almost universal. It goes alongside someone who's grieving. It goes alongside someone who has a difficult physical challenge, whatever it is. It's just about being together. But when we talked that maybe we actually want to mention some things that we want to avoid if we want to walk alongside someone in love. And when we talked about that, I immediately thought back to Job's friends. And if you are all familiar with the Old Testament story of Job, Job was a faithful man of God who sought to follow God as closely as he could with his life. And Job experienced some unimaginable suffering in the form of loss, in the form of pain, physical, emotional, and mental, all of it. And in the midst of that, some of his friends came over to provide Job some shall we say, comfort, but what happened in their advice, in their response, actually made it worse. And when we're talking about walking alongside one another in love, we want to make sure that we're not adding to someone's suffering. So, Allison, what are some specific things that we can do to show and share love for people? But before we get into that, what are some things that we should avoid?
Important to acknowledge is that it's really hard to be with difficult emotions, both within ourselves but also around other people. And so in that, sometimes we want it to go away, so we try to like make the person better or fix them really quickly, maybe because we care and we don't want them to feel that way, but also because it's really uncomfortable for us. So in that, though, we can often really invalidate or hurt the person more, so we just want to be really cautious of that. So sometimes we will hear things that invalidate emotions, like saying, oh, you just need to pray more about this, or we all get sad sometimes and you'll feel better soon, or maybe even, I think you're overreacting to this, or you need to stay more positive, or even sometimes saying, like, I know exactly how you feel isn't helpful, because we all have unique experiences, and so we likely do not know exactly how the person feels, and they might end up feeling like you're not really meeting where they're at, you're just kind of going through your own experience. Something else we can do is kind of bypass or invalidate emotions using scripture or misusing scripture. So we can kind of use the Philippians, be anxious for nothing, to try to tell someone not to be anxious, but that actually is just more hurtful for them or not helpful. I think you had kind of mentioned that at one point, that you had an experience like that.
Yeah, the experience that I shared at 8:15 and I shared a couple of weeks ago here, if you weren't with us, is when I was in high school, I was dealing with a lot of fear, specifically fear around death. And a well-meaning Christian friend at that time said to me, well, Larry, you know the Bible says perfect love casts out fear, so you just need to fill your life with more love and that fear won't have any place. And what I wanted to say to her was, well, the Bible also says do not allow a witch to live. But at that point, I didn't think that was appropriate or helpful to me or to her.
Yeah, so similar, we can also kind of use platitudes, like, or try to encourage using a concept like if someone has just lost a loved one, we might say, oh, it's okay, you know they're in heaven. Well, that's, true. It's also the person is still left grieving and having all of, that sadness and, all the emotions that come along with grief. And so if we jump to the hope that we have in heaven, we miss that opportunity to walk with them in the pain that they're experiencing.
That we can ask ourselves, we often say, well, is what I'm saying true? Yes, it's true. But another question to ask ourselves is it helpful? Yeah.
Absolutely. Lastly, I think just avoiding quick solutions. So there are things that we know that will help with our mental health, things like exercise, eating well, being more positive. All of those things are kind of puzzle pieces that help us work towards better mental health. But if we kind of quickly jump to that, a person who's really struggling often has trouble implementing those things, so then it becomes a list of things that they're not doing, which could add to more of a sense of like failure or shame. So we just want to be cautious of not overwhelming or jumping to quick solutions. We know that mental health is a very complex thing, and so we don't want to just jump to quick solutions.
There aren't always simple solutions to complex challenges. So on the flip side of that is, we do want to talk about what are some specific things that we can do to show someone that we love who's struggling that we care and that we love them. What are some of the ways that we can be with people who are hurting?
Yeah, I think first of all, we know that we are in a time of a lot of isolation, and that's for everyone, but even more so for people who are suffering or struggling with mental health. Can be such an isolating thing. And so reaching out, being present with them, I think, this concept of when we walk alongside with them, we walk in step with them, and so get close and check in. Similarly, I think listen without judgment, kind of meet them where they're at. Don't walk three steps ahead of them, but like walk with them. ask questions. Something that I often ask people is, what is the hardest part of this, or what's the most difficult thing about this? When we ask that, we allow them to go into their darker place and kind of enter into that with them. Now, when you ask that, you want to make sure that you're ready to listen, be non-judgmental, and meet them there. Otherwise, we have just opened them up to something very vulnerable, and then we invalidate them. So we just want to make sure that we're not damaging them anymore. We can also encourage, or gently encourage, positive steps. So those things like exercise, nutrition, going to appointments, reaching out to supports. Maybe someone mentions something like, oh, I wish that I would take a walk, or I know that I would feel better if I do this. Maybe you say, well, when can I meet you and do that? Maybe you can help them kind of implement that. It's helpful to point out their strengths and the things that you have seen them doing well, or progress that you've seen, because that helps give them kind of courage and confidence in themselves to keep going. Pray with the person. We are often, I think it's easy to say, I will pray for you, and I think that's important, but we also want to pray with the person so we can help them practice meeting God in their suffering. And I think it also helps to just really connect with that person. So you can do that over the phone. In person, of course, is always great. Even a text message, though, type out a prayer and send that to them. It lets them know that you're really there with them. Another thing is ask them how you can help. Everyone might have trouble doing different things, right? Or they might have different struggles. It might mean providing childcare so someone can go to an appointment. It might mean helping them with household tasks that they're just, not having the energy to do. But you're not going to know those things until you ask and are ready to meet them in that. I think the last thing that's really important is to observe healthy boundaries, and that's both with the person, for their boundaries, but also within yourself. So if someone sets a boundary, respect that. If they say, I don't think I'm able to do that, or that's not helpful for me, respect that. But also within yourself, tune into what you're able to give, what energy you have, both physical and emotional, and that way you know you can promise what you're actually able to do, and I think that's really important too.
One of the things that we talk about a lot at Faith Church is that we simply want to be like Jesus. And when we think about who Jesus was and is, Jesus is the one who left heaven to be present with us, to wrap our injured and our broken flesh around us and to walk alongside us. And so when we reflect Jesus with another person, it's going to be involving simply being there. And I love your language of getting close, because that's particularly important when someone is self-isolating. Now, you don't want to force yourself upon that. Obviously, that's where you respect boundaries, but make yourself present, make yourself known. And then I was just thinking, as you were speaking, Jesus asked questions way more than he gave answers. And if we want to reflect Jesus in the life of somebody who's hurting, maybe asking questions and listening for their answers is a really important part of that. So one of the things that we also know is that we shared a couple of weeks ago that there are a lot of folks, even in our congregation, who have or who are struggling with mental health issues. But that also means that there are a lot of people that are walking alongside them, that are wanting to walk alongside them. And so we want to care not only for those in the midst of the struggle, we want to care for the caregiver, if you will, the person walking alongside. So what are some ways that we as individuals, or even maybe we as a church, can care for the caregivers?
Yeah, I think kind of similarly to how you would care for someone who is in it, I think also getting close to those caregivers. And I think in this case, listening non-judgmentally, let me be clear about that, to what their struggles are. Oftentimes when we're around someone who's really struggling, they're not bringing out the best parts of themselves. So they might be more short, they might be more critical, or things that are hurtful to the people that are around them. And that can bring up frustration and a whole bunch of other things in the caregiver. So having a support that you can just say those things without fear of judgment, without fear of, you know, judgment of your loved one, I think can be really helpful. Again, being present and checking in, you know, being with them, because it actually helps them support the other person if you're supporting them too. I think something else for caregivers that's really important is to kind of check in and remind them that they need to take care of themselves. I'm sure many of you have already heard the analogy of the oxygen masks on an airplane, but whenever we fly, we get the instructions that if for any emergency, if the oxygen masks drop down, that you are supposed to put that mask on yourself first and take care of yourself so that you are able to take care of children or anyone else around you. So in the same way, we want to just remind the caregivers to be taking care of themselves so they have the strength and energy to keep going with their loved one.
Yeah, we believe that the second greatest commandment, if you will, that Jesus gave us is to love our neighbor as ourself, but we have a tendency to forget the as yourself piece, and that's putting on the oxygen mask first. Great, thank you. So Allison, I told Allison I was going to do this. Allison is a mental health care provider, and I know that we have other mental health care providers in our midst, and so we want to know, how do we care for you? How do we pray and support you? One of the things that you may or may not be aware of is, particularly in the last couple of years, the workload, the caseload for our mental health care providers in particular has increased exponentially. And one of the very specific ways that we know that is when we encourage, or when someone comes to me in the church and says, Pastor, do you have counselor or therapist that you can recommend to me or my family or things like that, one of the things that we know is there is often a 2 to 3 month wait to get into some counselors or therapists or mental health care providers. And that is simply because the caseload has exploded. And then also, it's just a really heavy season personally. So how can we pray for and care for those of you in the field who are on kind of the front lines of mental health?
Yeah, I think I appreciate you pointing that out because I think, you know, we do feel the weight. I think, you know, the mental health system was already probably pretty full and close to overload pre-pandemic several years ago, and just this has just magnified everything. So we are definitely feeling that pressure. So I think as far as prayer and recognizing too that people's problems are a lot more complex now and maybe more intense, so I think praying for us to have wisdom and strength and perseverance to continue to like know how to navigate and to just be as helpful as we can to the people that we work with is helpful. Also, I do appreciate that you guys are engaging with this series, because I think something that the church can do is offer support and community to both people in your community here at the church, but also as your neighbors. We know that like a strong support system is a really good predictor of resilience and being able to get through these difficult times. So if you are acting as a support, you are actually helping us as mental health providers too. So we, you know, I just encourage you to do that. As far as supporting us, I think be patient with us. We are having to say no when we don't want to say no, or saying we have to wait, and so just be patient with us. We are trying to, you know, work as much as we can, but also have to take care of ourselves, so I do appreciate that. I think something else, just knowing that mental health providers are often really other-focused, really engaging with difficult emotions, trauma, and different types of suffering, and that's a good part of our lives that we're doing that, so it's really helpful to have people just check in and say, how are you? How are things going? We're often asking other people that, so it's really powerful or helpful for us to like hear that and have people really listen to us and check in too. I was just curious if I could get anyone out there who is working in the mental health field now to raise their hand, because it might be helpful for your community to just recognize who you are too, to be checking in.
So if you're a mental health care provider, a guidance counselor, a social worker, will you just raise your hand where you are? Yeah.
And I know you have persevered a lot, and we appreciate you. Yeah.
And so some of our folks have raised their hands, we want to pray for you all, and we want to pray for Allison. So in just a couple of minutes, we're going to transition into communion, which is a reminder that God is with us in all of it. And so we want to remind you all of that as well. So will you join me in praying for all of our mental health care workers? God, you are good and you are powerful. You are loving and you are always with us. And one of the ways that you are with us and with so many others is through those who are working in mental health care fields, those who are counselors, those who are therapists, those who are aides, those who are caregivers, those who are psychologists and psychiatrists, those who are in nursing, those who are in schools, those who are in addiction and rehabilitation facilities. And God, we pray that your Spirit would pour out a double portion of blessing upon those in our own community who serve you in this way. Pray for your grace to reign powerfully in their lives. We pray that in the midst of caring for and sometimes bearing the burdens of so many, that you would surround them with us in ways that would help carry them in the difficult times. Help them be wise about their own boundaries, about their own self-care, about their care for others. God, we pray, thanking you for the gift of their hearts open to you and open to so many of us. And God, we also pray for others in our midst who may be those at-home caregivers, maybe those parents or children, those spouses, those friends, who are walking alongside others who are struggling even now. God, the road is often longer than we anticipate and filled with twists and turns, and a whole lot of hard in the midst of the good. We pray that you would help those folks put on their own oxygen masks. Breathe life into them in ways that allow them to breathe life into others. And we thank you for the model that we have in Jesus, who went away to a quiet place to be refreshed and reconnect with you, and then poured himself out for the sake of us and for the whole world. In his name we pray. Friends, will you just take one more opportunity to thank Allison for sharing with us this morning? And now we do turn to the communion table, perhaps the most perfect reminder that we are not alone, because the God who we know as Emmanuel, God with us, came. And when we gather around the table, we gather around the table not as individuals, we gather around the table together. And we are reminded of the story that makes us whole. And a part of that story is that on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread and he gave thanks to God and he broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after the supper was over, he took the cup and he gave thanks to God and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this every time you drink it in remembrance of me." And so when we gather around the table, we remember. We remember the story and we pray. And this is what we pray. We pray, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of the bread and the cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, make us one with each other, and then make us one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we all feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of God's children, let's pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. I'm going to invite those who will be helping to serve communion to come forward at this time. And as they do, I want to remind all of us that this table does not belong to Faith Church. It doesn't belong to the United Methodist Church. It belongs to Christ, and he has declared that all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and who seek to live in peace with God and with one another are welcome. And so we invite you. And this morning we'll be receiving communion by intinction, which simply means that we will invite you to come down the aisle to the left of your seat. You'll be handed a piece of bread at one of the four stations across the front, and then you'll be invited to dip that piece of bread into the juice and receive those gifts before returning to your seat by the side aisle. As always, we also have gluten-free elements available. Marion will have those here at the front if you need those. And there are some self-contained elements in the back of the FCC if you would prefer to receive that way. But now we invite you to come and receive. Thank you.
despair has left me blind. Sing me the tune I've left behind. Will you sing over me? Will you sing over me? Sing of the goodness I cannot see. Will you sing over me? When all the grief pours through my hands, when I've forgotten who I am, when I can't feel anything but shame, sing out and give me back my name. Will you sing over me? Will you sing over me? Sing of the goodness that I cannot see. Will you sing over me? Will you sing over me? When I sink down beneath the fear, the weight is more, it's more than I can bear. Keep singing up. I'll sing for you, I swear. Will you sing over me? Will you sing over me? Sing of the goodness that I cannot see. Will you sing over me? Will you sing over me? Will you sing over me? Oh, oh, sing of the goodness that I cannot see. Sing over me. Will you sing over me? Will you sing over me? Oh, sing of the goodness that I cannot see. Will you sing over me? Will you sing over me? Will you sing over me?
Pray with me. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this whole mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your spirits to give ourselves for others. That's what it means to sing over one another, friends. Amen. Thank you. We are going to sing one more song, right? One more song? And as we do, we're going to receive our gifts. And one of the ways that we say yes to Jesus is to say yes to his work in our midst. And so when we give of our lives, of our service, and of our tithes and offerings, we're saying thank you. And we're saying we want to be a part of what you're doing in the world. And so as we sing this last song, we're going to pass our offering baskets, and we invite you to give generously.
And as we do, you'll notice some new faces on the stage. The Voices Choir of Faith Church is joining us for this last number. And in lieu of this last sermon, this song is called By My Side. And it is from the Sanctuary Songs album that was written in lieu of worship leaders and mental health professionals. And for today, the message of this song, the first verse is, "Oh, my friend, just stay with me, stay with me, stay with me." And it resounds and echoes everything we heard today in the conversation of not just how to walk through it on your own, but also how to walk with someone who's going through the same thing. Y'all ready? All right. This is so exciting. Look at all these people.
My friend, just stay with me, stay with me, stay with me. Oh, my friend, just stay with me by my side. Oh, my friend, just
won't you please be by my side?
Thank you, Faith Church. Go in peace, and if you're able, we would love if you would help us tear down the chairs and put out some basketball hoops so we can love our community through and upward. And let's sing that chorus one more time to send all out. Sound good?
That's good.
Here we go.
Wherever I go, by my side, above and below.
Yeah, well, at an all-time low, but if I got you.